You're listening to the SWN podcast.
And this is SWN.
Welcome to SWN.
Skull! Skull! Skull!
This is SWN.
And this is the Scottish Wrestling Network.
Where Scottish wrestling lives, I guess. Is that a tagline? I guess. I don't know.
Hello and welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I'm your host as always. Good start to the episode. Good start. This stays in though. I've moved my microphone in case you're wondering, oh my god, that guy's got a wireless mic. It's not, it's here now. I am your host as always, Billy, if I haven't said that already, because my mind's gone blank. It's just crazy. I am joined by a very special guest. I'm excited to have this guest on. They've made a debut in the world of Scottish wrestling very recently. But wearing the stripes themselves, I always have a good idea for an intro, never works out. I am joined by Ref Katie.
Hello.
Now, do you prefer to go by Ref Katie or is there a
Katie? My actual name is Katie, so whatever you want. It's just, I have noticed that a lot of people, I think maybe because it's a one name that people know us for, and normally it's like a Rich Swift or a Charles Robinson. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So people give him the title a lot of the time, but you can call us whatever you want, really.
I'll bear that in mind, Kate. Right, so we'll go on to the whole episode. We've got lots of questions I want to ask, some from Instagram as well. But we start with the cliche icebreaker, the most legitimately boring question that I can ask you, but I know I'm going to get a good answer from it. What made you a fan of pro wrestling?
Oh, man, it was literally the first time we've seen it, so it was my brother's fifth birthday party. I was a year older, so I would have been six. He got given a Sting action figure, and that just changed the whole thing, because we were all like, who's this goth action figure? Do you know what I mean? Like, who is he? And then it was, I'm sure I've said this millions of times before already, but my mom is the one who's the big fan, and it was her who took my brothers to WCW when it came to the arena and took us to Insurrection and all that stuff, and would buy the pay-per-views so we could all watch them. We'd put them on a videotape and we'd pass them around the school, and like, we'd all share the pay-per-views. And a lot of it was probably starting to watch it, dipping in and out, but it was the Hardy Boys, and later it was the best thing I'd ever seen. And especially having two brothers, they would be Matt and Jeff, it always worked out, and I would be later, and we'd all just chin each other, do you know what I mean? It's just one of those things that's a bit of a family event.
The Hardy Boys, and Lita especially, I speak to so many, many people in this podcast now, and generally people like about my age and a little bit younger, Hardy Boys, they seem to have grabbed everyone's imagination at some point of some description. I mean, to the point where, you can probably see I've got the Hardy Boys in the background there with the old pops as well. I've got the Hardy Boys emblem tattooed. And it's just something about them, wasn't it? They were just cool.
Yeah, that's what it was. And like, as well, you're going to remember the time that we grew up watching it. It's like, you want it, you were a fan of the cool one. So Steve Austin, who was cool, and Steve Austin, he was the man who was giving it to the man. Do you know what I mean? And then you have like the what would you call him? Like Rogue, maybe? Like with Lita and the Hardys. I don't know. I just loved it. They got me straight away. It was as soon as I seen Lita doing that, the assault, I was like, oh my days, that is amazing. But I've never wanted to wrestle. I have never, ever, ever wanted to be the one in the ring taking the bumps. I've always wanted to be the ref. Zero interest in me being the one in the ring. I'm watching what these are doing. These are crazy people. I don't want to do that. I'm happy to just watch it. Maybe take one bump every now and again, but not really at the same time.
So you want to get as close as possible, but not actually be a wrestler. That's smart thinking. Lita had been totally different to anything else on the show. Same with the Hardys, really. They had the cargo trousers, they had the cool boots, all the colourful hair for Jeff and everything like that. Now, I know I've done this as well, but have you ever specifically bought cargo trousers specifically because of the Hardy Boys?
I've got a green pair now through there. I'm dying to wear them. I don't know when, but I'm waiting for it.
Halloween's coming up. Lita cosplay.
I was thinking about doing Charles, because one of my friends actually has the wig, and she got us the the ref shirt with the WWE, like, you know, the stitched on and everything. So I was like, do I go crazy and literally put the Charles wig on and just run down somewhere and say, like, run down Northumberland Street?
So you said, like, wrestling, actually wrestling yourself, no interest in that at all. Refereeing itself, were you always kind of concentrating on the referee because you knew that was something you wanted to do? Was there referees that you liked watching more than others? Where was the kind of point there?
Well, right. So pretty much like everybody that you'll speak to, you have a phase where you dip out. And when I dipped out, like I really dipped out. And then when I dipped back in, that was when it started, like in my head, I'm like, I'd love to do that. It was Daniel Bryan, WrestleMania. That's when I got back into it. And I remember being like, God, I'd love to have been in that ring there and like thinking about it like that. And then I remember Googling referee training, nothing came up at the time. And I thought, how would you even know? And I thought, it's going to be one of those things where you'll have to know somebody to get a shot. So it'll never happen. And then I was at a North show about a year and a half ago. It was the NCL Cup one, I think. And I was watching the refs and I was like, this is insane. Like, these refs are amazing. And now my coach, Rich Swift, so that's how that one worked out. Like, you know, just saying, manifest it. And I was with someone who I told, like, I would love to do that. They were like, really? And so they took us around the back of the venue to meet H.T. Drake, who was there. And I'm not sure they were on that show, but they do the ring as well. And he just put Ross through, who I'll speak about, I'm sure, multiple times, ref Ross. And he just put Ross through on shows. And so he told us to come to training on the Wednesday. I did. And then it just spiraled out of control. I never stopped going. And then I would go to some ref James Greenwood sessions in Future Shock in Manchester. And then Rampage Brown opened up Rampage Training again up in Chester Lee Street. And ref Rich Swift was there. And mate, game changer, having pretty much one-on-one ref training with somebody who is incredibly talented, not like has worked for WWE before, so this is like all of, like, really intense knowledge and training. You know what I'm trying to say, but it's going to take us too long to put that in order, so we'll just move on. But I learned so much so fast in being around so many other refs, like Scott Bell. I've learned so much off Scott Bell as well. Especially, I did one incredible training session down at Evo in Grimsby. You should go, you know, it's so much fun. I'm dying to go back. It's a mission, but I'm dying to go back. It's so worth the mission because I was doing front bumps and everything by the end of it. It was brilliant. But what else? I do this all of the time. What was the question?
The question was how you got into wrestling. I'm in the cul-de-sac. I've forgotten what I've asked. This could be a very interesting thing.
This all the time.
I'm rotten for remembering my own question, so don't worry about it. So you said you went to North, the NCL Cup show. Was that your first independent show, or are we aware of? Because Northeast is buzzing with independent wrestling companies right now. So yeah, what was your first independent experience?
It was so good. It was the first ever WCPW show. They did two nights and went both. It was incredible. And after that, it was like, we just seen Jay Lethal and Walker, like around the corner from where we live. So we just started going. Me and my mom, when I'm saying we, it's me and my mom as well. So we'd start going home and then we'd say like, oh, ICW's doing a tour. We'll go to that. And then eventually I started going to the Glasgow to see, because it was like, I couldn't get enough, you know what I mean? But at the time when I started going to the indies, it was basically during the boom where, like I say, there was WCPW, which turned into Defiant later on. But then you had all the other companies, like Progress was touring. There was so much everywhere that it was just all consuming, but in the best way, probably the way I'm now. And that's how it all started with the indies.
I'll get back to that in a second without punching my microphone. You said you had your dip out of wrestling and you came back to it for the Daniel Bryan WrestleMania. Was your mum always keeping you up to date? Did you ask for updates or did you get
updates? Oh, I don't know if I asked. I think I just got them. But like how I get the updates of the Newcastle squad. And...
So who's her favourites then? No,
John Moxley.
Oh, sorry.
John Moxley, Mick Foley. You wouldn't think it to look at her because she's such a pretty Jane Austen little delicate thing. But she's a hardcore like legend. Like that's her thing.
So she'll be pushing you to. What does she think of you getting involved in? Is that just the best thing ever, or?
She loves it. She really does. She's been at a few times now, and probably my personal favorite time she's seen is I ended up doing a whole show for a company called Full Tilt Wrestling, but they run out at the bar where my late granddad drank every week, or not every day, but every weekend he would go down. Or maybe about 40-odd, 50 years. So that was pretty special to see her. What she'd never seen at that point. And then she ended up watching us too. I think it was 14 because there was a trainee show as well. So she got a fair share of watching us. But it was just, because the venue and everything, it was pretty special. I'm not going to lie. And it only took her 2 minutes to get home because she only lives down the road.
I love that. There's one promotion that comes up my way like twice a year. And it's literally 5 minutes from my house, and it's the best thing. Otherwise, I've got to take it's an hour and a half if I want to get to a show. And I usually do like road trip episodes of the podcast for this, and it's the shortest episodes ever because I'm literally 5 minutes. I'm in the car. I'm there. All right. Okay, I'm going to go into the show now. Come out 5 minutes home. but it's great to have wrestling on your doorstep. Like I say, the Northeast is just incredible right now for that. For wrestling, and the fact that you had Defiant or WCPW on your doorstep as well, and I never got into WCPW at the time, and again it's a whole generation of wrestlers nowadays or wrestling fans, certainly that was their gateway to the independent scene and seeing all these larger than life figures in wrestling, and I can all imagine being in that moment. I mean, I saw the boom here in Scotland a little bit, but it's just independent wrestling was just the hottest ticket in town, and it is getting there. I think, especially in England, right now it's just on fire. Scotland, it's there, it's getting there, it's almost back to where it was, but there could be another spark somewhere if to be honest. But anyway, back to you, because this is your podcast, this is a show about yourself. So the training then, you said play trainers, you picked up lots of mentors along the way, but what was your first kind of thoughts of those first couple training sessions, and was there anything that came like surprise to you when you were learning?
I think if you asked anyone, it was just so much fun. It was genuinely being like wound up to go have fun and then let it go and have loose. I think a lot of people were thinking, who the hell is this? And I know a few of them said that they didn't think I'd be back because, well, I've gained probably about a stone and a bit now since I started, but I was a tiny little frail thing. I was just covered across, so beyond happy to be there, that it was a bit like a borderline lunatic. And I think as well, right, because again, and I'll always try and I'll do the roles and all that stuff. Well, not as much at the minute because I had a sore hand, but anyways, that's a different story. Hold on. Oh, yeah, it was a lot of going over the basics of being in the ring first. So it wasn't a quick, here's how to ref or anything like that. It was a bit, pretty much like, here's how the basics are, this is what the warm-ups are, this is what a set go, a lock-up, like, because it is really important and all those things, do you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. But for me, it was just so much fun. It was like, I remember after the first one, I felt like, when I would walk away the next day, I felt like, I feel like I'm in Fight Club, like, do you know what I mean? I'm like, sorry, the chihuahua is still going inside, he's on high alert. But yeah, honestly, I remember walking through town the day afterwards, aching. No, I did. I went to Durham on a huge walk around, crippled. I didn't think I'd be that bad. I remember walking up all these stairs, like, it's so much pain because I've never done any of that, like, high interval intensity training. I actually think I got that one right there. But It was brutal on my body, but I got over it.
I mean, because I don't know if you thought coming in you were just going to learn, right, I need to slap the mat three times,
yeah,
I need to count to five, count to ten. Easy, I can do that, I'm asleep. It was more about ring awareness and knowing the actual what looks right and what looks wrong, pretty much, was that the main things you learned starting off with.
Yeah, 100%. And, you know, it was a genuinely really good environment to learn in. It was, there was so many people as well. And I've met people along the way that will go training here, there and everywhere, and we'll pick up as much knowledge as we can. But it was such a good place to start. It was because there was so many people, and it was often split between like people doing stuff in the ring and people doing other stuff on the outside. You were constantly learning, especially, like I say, for someone like me who didn't have a clue, even learning how to do a proper lockup and making that nice sweet joint, like that sweet noise, you know what I mean? Like that sort of stuff. I can't remember the question once again. I'm so sorry.
That's absolutely fine. We'll move on a little bit further into you getting your first match to referee. So how long was that? About 6 months was I getting from your timeline there? So how long was it until you got to do your first proper match?
About 4 months, I'd say. Maybe four and a half. Yeah, I wouldn't say about four and a half.
What was your memories of that?
Hmm?
What were your memories of that first match?
Oh, fear. Total fear. But honestly, and again, I'll probably bring him up multiple times, but I had Ross, I had Tim Strange, who is, I love Tim Strange so much. He's such a supportive guy. And I had such a supportive group of people around us. And it was at Burnley Pro. And it was meant to be Lily Winter and Hannah Taylor. I think there was something happened where Hannah couldn't make it anymore. And so last minute, we'd got Mel Price in, which had already just been on the show. And I remember thinking to myself, like I don't think this match is going to happen. Like, I was hell-bent it wasn't going to happen. I found out when I was there as well that was a title match. I was like, the first matches for the belt. Like, oh, my God. And I found out it was going to be on YouTube. And it was just a lot of fear. And I remember thinking, my pants look so stupid. Like, I couldn't find any pants that would look good, like that would even just look normal. Like I say, I used to be really, really thin, and I should have been wearing teenager pants, really. But I tried to find the smallest adult work pants I could find, and they poofed out loads. And so it just, you know, and I had a stupid belt on, and it was all this stuff. I wasn't used to people talking to me here, but we did it. And I wrapped Lily the other week, actually. But yeah, it's not as horrible as I remember. I watched it back not that long ago when I was at another referee's house, LK's house, and we'll watch back with debuts. Definitely, like, I'm definitely not as bad as I remember in it. But all I remember, and you can see it all over my face, is how terrified I was. And I remember being shocked at how scared I was, because I'm not a shy person at all. But it was like every moment of shyness that I'd missed out in my life, it all built into one moment in the ring. Do you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Like, I would like to redo that match.
I mean, when you're saying that all the things, all the factors thrown into there, like not being happy with what you're wearing, which is a whole other thing. And then, yeah, title match. So you've got to remember a million other things with the belt. You've got to remember to hold it up. Remember to hold it up the right way and not do a great Kali and hold it upside down. You've got to remember to show it to them. You've got to do all the little intricate and subtleties with that. And then, yeah, you're on YouTube, which YouTube is an experience in itself for comment sections or what have you, and wrestling fans being hidden behind usernames. And if they're going to pick at something, they'll find something to pick at. Yeah. So, a little bit of pressure going into it. So after that, after your match, was the first thought, I need to get better gear. What was the first kind of immediate
thought? I want to do that again. I remember it was the first thing I think it was the first thing I said was, I want to do that again. It was so much fun. And I remember, and you can even see it on the video, but I do remember it was like a mesh paneling where the divide between the crowd and the talent was, and then there was a curtain here because it was in this big like sports hall. It's a really good venue actually. And I remember seeing like the outline of Tim Strange's cowboy hat watching, and like all of the other refs, so like Ross and Reese, who are incredible, they were all there, and there was a lot of people watching because I didn't meet people along the way. And I remember thinking like, it's okay if I mess up because they are all there, like, do you know what I mean? So that, to be totally honest with you, the saving grace was seeing the outline of everyone, because I was like, even if it goes bad, like, it's okay, there's like this group of people, do you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. I can't remember what the question was, but I do remember how much pressure there was.
That's fine. It was, yeah, first or afterwards, but that's cool. Tim Strange, we had on podcast recently, and he's, yeah, it's just one of those guys. If he knows or can sense the passion you have for wrestling, you'll go above and beyond to help you reach those goals and to help you as much as you can. He's fantastic. It took us about 6 months to finally arrange a chat because he was that busy, but mm-hmm. on shows, and finally got it in, and it was absolutely worthwhile because by that point he was proper cowboy Tim Strange, and we got to talk about cowboy hats, and I was excited about that myself. Don't know why. I think I'm still a child at heart. Cowboy hats are still cool. They are. They're just any name a wrestler that wouldn't look cooler without a cowboy hat. Yeah, Stone Cold Steve Austin, cowboy hat, cooler.
Mate, him with his cowboy hat and his little kitten on his farm is the best thing I've seen in a while.
Stone Cold Steve Austin, now viral sensation, not for the things you think. missing WrestleMania because his cat, he wanted to look after his new cat. That's dedication to pets mm-hmm. that you can only hope for. So I'm going to escape your actual wrestling journey for a moment, because I do a little bit of research when I do these podcasts, and most of it for referees, unfortunately, it's just me scrolling through Instagram, because there's not a database on Cage Match or anything like that for referees, which is disgraceful, and there should be, because it would make my life so much easier. It wouldn't be cool to like go through like a match card and seeing, oh, Charles Robinson did this match, Mike Chioda did this match. That'd be just, get on it, Cage Match. I would do it myself, but that seems like a lot of work that I don't want to do.
It is a lot of work.
I was going through and I was seeing that you've had your fair share of experiences seeing the wrestling live, not just independence, but going over to for WrestleManias and WrestleCons, yeah. and things like that. The one picture that came to my attention, and you've already mentioned them because it makes me insanely jealous when I saw it, was meeting Jeff Hardy. Now, in saying that, you've admitted yourself that you do like a ramble, you do like to chat on. What was it like meeting Jeff Hardy?
Right, I didn't have many words, mate. I really didn't. It was more noises. It was more just like, I'm bad for this. I've been starstruck a few times in my life, right? Not loads, but about four times I reckon, genuinely starstruck. And I'm too busy, like, looking at them, like, wow, you really do look like that. You know, where there's something about, like, where you know somebody's face so much that when you see them in person, it's like, oh, yeah, you really do look like that. And I think I just made noises, mate. I didn't say a whole lot, to be honest. I didn't shut the F up when I was speaking to Lita. That was a different story because I had a bit more time with Lita. But it was when I met Jeff, it was the morning of when he came back. Was it? Or was it the day before? No, it was the day before. So I'd met him on Saturday, and then on Sunday he came back to the Mania in Florida. And that was the first time in America, first time dealing with anything. And I think they'd got caught up doing a lot of stuff with the WWE, and so they were really late. And so everybody's meet and greets was like, go say hello, here's your picture, bye! And I was still like, okay, still mint, whatever, right? But yeah, I didn't say a whole lot, I just made noises.
Well, we do have something in common then, because when I met Lita, I did not endear myself very well, because I just started. It's the same thing. I saw her and I was like, in my head, I was going, oh my God, that's what she looks like. She actually looks like how I've seen on the TV. And then I just absolutely garbled nonsense, and I'm not proud of myself for it. It was just, I felt embarrassed afterwards, but she was very pleasant, so not her fault. I was just like, like this is.
I probably used to it.
One of my first ever crushes when I was like 9 years old, and I'm now meeting her in real life. It's like, promising I wasn't going to sell her autograph on eBay was possibly my my downfall. But we do these things. For that kind of WrestleCon kind of thing, this is before you started training yourself. So were you able to meet, did you meet any referees that you were able to maybe try and subconsciously pick some tips off of?
I never, maybe I just missed it, but I never seen any refs there. There was so many people. I met Mick Foley, a couple of them now. I met Jim Duggan. I have a lovely little friendship with Jim Duggan. Right? It was so unexpected, but we got along like a house on fire. We ended up hanging out for a bit later on. Jonathan Coachman, like the actual most beautiful human I've ever seen in person is Jonathan Coachman. That one threw us for a surprise. Got sniffed by Bischoff. That was a bit weird, I'm not going to lie. I've got that one in picture where I'm literally horrified. He's getting a good. That happened. In this photo proof. What else? I don't know. I don't think I've got any refs. I don't think I've seen any.
Well, I mean, that's going to be the title of the episode now. SWN Podcast. Ref Katie gets sniffed by Eric Bischoff.
I do have the picture somewhere. I was horrified.
Jim Duggan, though. Again, and someone who I've had the pleasure to meet. He was like my first WWE wrestler I ever met, like one of them, and I turned up, it was him, Billy Gunn was on the show that I was at in the Northeast for WrestleZone, and I arrived with my little plastic, my foam WWF tag team title to get Billy Gunn to sign, and I got him to sign it, and Jim Duggan was right next to him, and he went, do you want me to sign your belt? I'm like, yes. I had no moment to go, you've never won this belt, Jim. Yes, you can sign this. You have offered. I have not paid for this. So you go sign it. Go for it. So yeah, so I think I'm the only person on this planet will have a foam WWF title belt, the tag team title belt, signed by Billy Gunn and Hacksaw Jim Duggan.
Because why not?
It's meeting wrestlers is the absolutely most terrifying experience ever. Are you still finding it that way, even though now you've done a year worth of shows?
Yeah, mate, I'm not even going to lie. Like, I think as well, I definitely didn't expect for it to spiral and whirlwind so fast and be so lucky as I have been. So I feel like I'm just a fan taking it as far as I can go. And I'm meeting, obviously, to learn matches and stuff like that. And I'm meeting these people and I'm just like, I'm such a fan of yours. I know, like, people will tell us, I'll probably get being like, you shouldn't say that, but I am. I'm such a fan of so many people, do you know what I mean? Like, I'm such a fan of my coaches, too. And, I struggle sometimes, I'm not going to lie, because, like, you get the whole, I can't believe I'm going to be in the ring with you, and your heart starts going. It's just like, it's not, like, anything other than, I've admired these people, do you know what I mean? Like, I admire what they do in the ring, I admire what they're doing. And so it's a lot of, it's, how do you put it, Dave? Because you've got a lot of respect for them, you know.
Yeah, and also, like, on the flip side, you don't want to be part of their story. Like, when they do a big shoot interview and they go, oh, I had this show in Newcastle and the referee was rotten. And you don't want to be watching it and going, I think that was me refereeing that match. That's the fear of being part, being... Yeah, you don't want to be in their autobiography as the rubbish referee.
WrestleMania fear as well, man.
That doesn't help that Maff's at North shows and in the North. I know. Area, and he's going to see it one on one, real life, any mistakes you make, and he can note them down, going, I saw this at this time, kind of thing as well. I don't know how big or how kind of big guys are, like, Cultaholic are up in the Northeast, as in if they're kind of got celebrity status there, but must be kind of cool, like, sort of being at North shows and Matthew and Tom are there. Northeast of England is this proper big hub of wrestling, and you're part of it. So that must be amazing as a fan that you started watching, you started seeing shows there.
I mean, I'm not going to lie, it's pretty mental. Like, I remember, it wasn't that long ago. It was at Walker Dome. Like, everyone came out for the Thunderstruck show. At the Walker Dome, it was incredible. And I remember looking around the room, and at one point, I'm sure it was Jabba was over there, and there was Elias over there. And then there was like me or you mashed out over there. And I remember being like, what the hell am I doing in this room with these people? Do you know what I mean? Like just a mixture of not even just from in the Northeast, but I think it was maybe the mashup of everything in the Northeast. It was like, what is going on? And how am I like, how am I on this side? Do you know what I mean? How am I on this side of the barrier? Like sometimes I do look around and I think I'm waiting for security to drag us off.
Oh man, I remember. When, I mean, I like this just now. It's just a chat. I'm just telling my experiences at the same time. But I remember when I did some car runs for Rock and Wrestle up in Inverness area. So I'd drive them from Aberdeen to Inverness, or I ended up being roped into a show in Edinburgh. So I had to drive Inverness up to Inverness and down to Edinburgh, and picked up, name dropping, Clang, Christopher Daniels, Frankie Kazarian,
Nice.
and Chris Masters I had in this car in Edinburgh, which I'd never driven before, terrified. And somehow, at one point, I was sitting in a room, and they were there, and then Jack Jester was there, and Kaylee Ray was there, and Nikki, no, it wasn't Nikki Storm. It was Nikki Storm. Nikki Storm
Yeah,
was there.
Nikki Cross, yeah.
And I was sitting here just thinking, what, they shouldn't have let me in. Kind of thing.
Yeah,
Like,
that's it.
I shouldn't be here. Just, why am I here? Kind of thing. Got a couple
I feel
pictures and
like
everything, and then I look terrified in all the pictures at the same time because it was dark and I was tired, and I was like, I can't believe this has happened. They've let me do this. And that's why I get surprised when yourself or any of the other previous guests will go, yeah, I'll come on your podcast. Why?
I
Why am
get shocked that you're asking. I'm thinking, what? Like, I see this with a lot of love, but I'm thinking, what the hell do people want to ask me? You know what I mean? Right.
I just loved the feedback and all the love you got for debuting at ICW, and I was like,
Oh, thank you.
people really like this Katie character. I think I need to give this. I need to have a chat with her. And the fact that you've debuted, you made your ICW debut back in June,
Know. I
and.
know.
And I was looking to see the card and some of the matches that you were part of, and one being Grado, being part of Grado's match.
May Grado's return.
Exactly. So like that's a big moment to speak about. So we're gonna just gonna jump to that because Scottish Wrestling Network. I should really supposed to be about Scottish wrestling at some point.
Oh, sorry.
That's
And
all right.
there's so many brilliant, like, oh, let's go.
ICW. Then you got the call. How did that happen?
Right. So, oh, mate, I love this story. Right, so Tom, obviously, everyone knows and loves Thomas Cairns, like brilliant referee, genuinely brilliant referee. He'd tweeted out any Newcastle or Northeast refs, like hit him up now. And I got sent it by everyone because everybody knows, like, my goal for everything has always been ICW because I've always been such a fan and it's been such like a absolute pinnacle of UK wrestling where it's been like, in my mind, it was completely unattainable, and that's why I used to call it my delusional goal. Do you know what I mean? And now, mate, keep your delusions coming because it's a good time when they pop up, you know. But go back a little bit, sorry. And so I got asked to send some footage over. I'm pretty sure I'd sent a match of Amir Jordan and Will Cruz that I did at North. That was, oh, mate, anyone, they're quickly though, everyone should go watch that match. It was so good. But anyways, go back to story. I sent that match over, and then I just got the mail saying, "Yeah, let's do it. Let's go for it and see you at the Newcastle show." And mate, I was sat. The mail went to a different folder. I was sat refresh, 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 and I didn't see it until maybe like 6 hours later. And I was like, honestly, I was driving myself crazy. I was like, it's okay if I don't even expect it. Why would I? Do you know what I mean? And then when I seen that, I was like, oh, I have no shame. I was so full of emotion that I was welling up because it was like, I see what the card was going to be as well. It was like, oh, mate, like, you know, these are the people that got you to be in love with indie wrestling, like Jack Jester. You know what I mean? Like, in fact, not that long ago as well, Jack Jester, Scotty Roark, BWR, Ref Ross, and insane job in that match. That match was brilliant. It's great seeing Jack Jester about, honestly, it really is, because I think he's just top, you know what I mean? But and brilliant to work with, like, we're four even by any of it. But I'm sure that'll be a question in a minute. Sorry, I'm going off track. And then it was just a case of show up, try not to screw it up and try and be okay. But it, I remember for the, when I found out I had the grade O match, I remember being like, what is my life? This is the, like, most, this is the most insane one yet. Because I knew, like, how am I not going to just beam when I hear the start of the theme? Do you know what I mean? Like, how am I going to keep me cool? And I remember, I genuinely did. I don't often do this. Like, I tried so hard to stay in the zone, but I genuinely did let myself have a minute in the ring to just, like, take the room in when he was doing his entrance, coming in, you know how he is. It was before he got to the ring, so before I needed to, like, help him in or anything, which, can you believe I did that, right? And I honestly, I really did. Like, I let myself enjoy the moment, and, like, I really took it in. I don't often do that, and I'm going to remember that forever. That was probably, that's one of my most favourite, like, memories and moments of all time, because it was so surreal. Like I say, being on this side and being in the ring and knowing that it's live, and even having, like, the ICW headset in, which I couldn't keep on me at the time. I have definitely got better at it, though. But every time I would pin a thing off. But it was getting used to that and, like, being able to talk back, which is a really cool headset. Like, I've never seen comms like it so, so advanced. Like, I'm talking about, in my mind, I use walkie-talkies, you know what I mean? So these are just, like, these two-way systems are really cool. But that whole show, hey, mate, it was so good, man. Like, it, ICW, hometown, Great O's return, like, even, oh, the Teddy Williams match, oh, it was so good, with Will Cruz as well, it was so good, and Shreddy, oh, that Shreddy match, I've got a picture as well where Shreddy, like, you know, because at the end of the match, like, it was a, you know, quick roll up, 1, 2, 3, and Shreddy's doing his whole kicking off, and he came up in the corner, and he's, like, doing the whole as if he's going to punch, and, like, prop, I went for it to be scared, the whole thing, it was just so good, it, oh. And main event, mate, if you can go back as well and watch that main event. I wasn't in the main event, but I watched the main event. The main event was sick. Rory Coyle and Jack Jester, like, come on, what more do you want? Do you know what I mean? But yeah, it was honestly, like, you can see how excited I am talking about it now. It was brilliant. It really was. Like, if I could, I don't even know. Like, it's so much to take in at once. Like, you're kind of just like, okay, screw it, let's go. Do you know what I mean?
I mean, it really did. It did seem like that. It was a night tailor made for you, as well. Because, right? Like, saying,
and having Rampage on too.
Just that Grado and you're in Newcastle and ICW. Yeah, it's just, it just seems like it had to be your show that you had to be on, and then it's on Triller. So it's there forevermore. People can go and,
yeah, no,
and watch it. And how many times you went back to watch it?
Mate, I don't even want to admit. Right? Not as many times as I've rewatched the Cage show, but I'm not going to lie about that one.
We'll talk about that. We'll talk about that shortly. So yeah, you made your return at Bard, but I want to talk about Thunderstruck again, because that show, Thunderstruck 2, I saw the hype for this. I saw the size of the venue, the size of the crowd, the sound of the crowd as well. Again, is that another one that maybe you didn't think what's your kind of bucket list like? Is it refereeing in front of a massive crowd? Is it refereeing at a certain venue? Do you have anything like goals in that respect?
To be totally honest with you, mate, and I don't really like to say this because it does sound incredibly arrogant, but I've ticked off a fair few already that, like, I'm not really sure, other than doing all women shows and, like, you know, my mind's on blank because I'm so full of all this stuff that I want to see. I'll come back to the later on, but my bucket list was Ref Walker Dome, which was their Thunderstruck was. I'm from Walker. I used to do PE in that room. Do you know what I mean? Like, again, very sentimental, and North gave us so much. They've been so good to us since the start, like, giving us pre-shows to get reps in and see if I could, like, do it, and then just constantly giving opportunity after opportunity. I'm so grateful for everything North have done for us. Like, it's just insane. It really is. And they're again this Saturday, like, oh wait, I'm looking at the card and my mind's like, wow, like, thinking about what we could have and, like, how incredible it's going to be and how, like, the room is just going to be on fire because it is the first show after Thunderstruck. foot in as well. I got to take off another one really recently, which was to ref for Rampage Brown. I got to do that with PWR in Fife the other week. It was an incredible show. And, well, so ICW was my delusional goal. Do you know what I mean? And being on PWR was another goal. And it's just so many people have been. I do feel sometimes like I'm just incredibly lucky. And it's as if I've got this little imp on my shoulder bringing out like good luck everywhere. Do you know what I mean?
It's incredible community that I'm exploring more and more, this referee community. It seems to be coming through. I mean, I've, on this journey of podcasting, last 300 odd episodes, I've had a couple of referees on. I've had Sandy Beaches.
Love Sandy. World of Sports Sandy.
Yeah, so she was fantastic. She was the recommendation again from Ian Skinner, who I will probably bring up again in the next little bit. I've had likes of I'm now blanking on all the referees that I've had on. Chris Quinn, who's done a few ICW shows. He does sort of the Northeast. Dennis Law, who is the head referee up in WrestleZone in the Northeast as well. And it's a fascinating thing. Well, Sean Moran, who I just spoke to last week. That should have been one that was on the forefront of my mind. Apologies, Sean. So yeah, it seems like it's a very inclusive community that there seems to be just a big group chat, or at least a group hub of referees and zebras that just hang out and chat. Is it a case of maybe bouncing off ideas, or is it more just checking on promotions or wrestlers? What's the kind of vibe in that? I don't need to know the exact
group chat. In the community?
Yeah.
In all honesty, mate, I think it's we're all friends, like actual friends. Like, I would hang out with these people, and I do because I want to. Like, for example, my counterpart at Rampage Training, I say counterpart, is way better than me. It's Ref Ross. Ross has turned into one of my best friends in real life, and we couldn't be any different as people. But I think we just get along so well. Like, this, he's turned into one of my genuine best friends. You've got the refs at PPW, it's Sandy Lee. I genuinely love talking to these people. I genuinely love hanging out with them. For coaches, James Greenwood, Rich Swift, incredible. I can't over enough. He's the best. Like Scott Bell as well, one of the best referees you'll ever meet. I really love them all. Like, I love hanging out with them. Like, as well, I've got to mention, because I just love her so much, Scott's soon-to-be wife, Jess. Like, I love his wife. Do you know what I mean? Like, Jess is amazing to me. Like, I love this woman. And we're just actually friends. Like, I think because you get so used to people as well, being around them. You work with people so much. Like, you just develop a lot of friendships fast, I guess. We're all kind of, you know, same kind of vibe. And we all get along. It's just supportive, mate. Especially, like, you know, you go somewhere like Manchester and you've got your Future Shock referees. That's a huge group of people that are all training together. It's not competition. Training together. It's incredibly supportive. I think the best way for us to describe it is there's no sense of rivalry, bitterness, none of that crap. It's really supportive. It's, hey, I can't do this, but do you want to do it? Like, it's a lot of, like, reaching out. It's a lot of stuff like that, you know. It's a lot of, like, showing up to help out. It's a lot of recommendation. It's a lot of, hey, for example, I didn't know what comes set to buy. Like, I'm 30 yards. Like, I don't know what walkie-talkies are good these days. Sandy, like, my talent is out. Like, I don't know what to do. Here's the ones I use. Here's the yes pieces I use for it as well. Okay, like, I'm really struggling with a shirt. Here's the one I have. Like, you know, direct links and everything. And the training and the coaching, they don't need to give us that. They are doing this because they want to, because they're supportive. They're not doing it because, you know, I don't know, but they might get a buzz. I don't know, because they might get a buzz to know. So I don't know, because they know they don't. I don't know. That's whatever. I'm being tongue-tied and mental now. But it's support, mate. Like, honestly, it really is support. I've got really good friendships with a lot of good referees, and I've yet to meet a ref I haven't gone along with.
You mentioned there, and I think that's the important point, is there's no competition. It's not like it's wrestlers trying to compete for a spot on a card. It's like, no, exactly. you're a very important cog in the machine to keep things rolling. But it's no stopping. If a match card comes up and You see, for example, you mentioned you've refereed a match for Rampage, Brian. That was one of the matches you wanted to do. But if there's a match on there that you really wanted, I mean, there's no skin off anyone's nose as a referee.
Exactly.
Unless, like, the only time it would be maybe a difference maker is if there's supposed to be a planned big bump or something like that. Something that possibly you're not able to do, or somebody can do it a bit better or something like that. I suppose that's the only time maybe this person has to do this match kind of thing. Would I be right in saying that?
Yes, well, and it's not a written rule, but like, for example, at North on Saturday, it's going to be Ref Rich Swift, Ref Ross, and me. You know that if there's a particularly tricky match, and tricky isn't a bad thing, by the way. Tricky's just, let's say, there's a few extra spots with a bump. Like, you know, that would probably go to Rich, just because why would, and Rich has said this as well before, why would Rich want to give us something where we wouldn't excel? Mm-hmm. Do you know what I mean? It would just put her down. Like, is that a lot of refs now think about stuff like that too, where it's they don't want to screw. We don't want to screw anyone over. Like, why would we want to do that? Do you know what I mean? So a lot of like ability placement, like not even ability placement makes it sound awful.
But no, like so if someone's confident, more suited, more confident for like a death match or something, that it makes more sense for them to do
I'm
that.
I'm not going
to
do a death match. Like, imagine that, throwing me in there with the gloves and the goggles, I'd be blind. Like, I think I wouldn't even know. I'd be looking for the Bunsen burner. But then you've got people like Scott Bell who were getting there. And you see, there's a video of Scott Reffin where, like, I think it's, what's his name? Big F and Joe's backyard death match thing where there's this whole chaos going on, light tubes, Bob Ryan, Scott's on a trampoline in the background, but he knows what to do. Do you know what I mean? Like, he deals with it all. He's the best, you know? Like, if anyone wants to go learn about death matches, go see Scott, go see James Greenwood. Like, there's people for it, you know what I mean? Like, there's all, and that's the thing. So really quickly as well, if there's something you want to learn, there is always someone who can teach you as well. That's the thing, no matter how obscure, someone will know. You know what I mean?
So in saying that then, now that you're a referee, and you have been for over a year now, when you go back and watch shows, not just yourself, but like actual WWE shows, AW, Japan, whatever you watch, can you switch off between being a fan watching the wrestling, or does your eyes always kind of drift to the referee? Yeah.
The ref, everything. Even if, because you got to remember, like, WWE and TNA as well. TNA refs are really good. Like, I really rate Ref Allison Lee and Ref Page as well. And I'm not just in Ref Lady, Lady Ref Jess, she's called on it. That's where, like, Twitter handle or something. Ref Jessica Carr. No, I'm not just purposely trying to name the women. It's just these are the women that I'm watching as well. And like, I feel like I'm watching and I'm learning. But I'm not just watching them. I'm watching what the wrestlers are doing. And then I'm quickly flicking at what the refs doing to react to them. So even if I'm not always watching the ref, I'm always watching the ref. You know what I mean?
Speaking of Jess, she's one of my favorite referees to watch, just to see, because she just looks so authoritative. I don't know if it's because a lot of her matches, she was like Edge's handpicked referee for a lot of his matches. Yeah. She just seems like you wouldn't mess with Jess. That's pretty much with it. Like, you should do that with any referee. But yeah, you just look at her, you go, Christ, I think if you were out of line, she'd probably like rip your head off quite easily. So you don't mess with her. But no, it's fascinating to watch. I mean, I've been watching wrestling long enough now. 25 years now, so I try to find new things to pay attention to, and it's always fascinating to like watch a match and go, right, I'm gonna see what the ref does here. I'm gonna see what the tag team guys do in the corner with their tag rope and all that kind of stuff. And you find new and interesting ways to watch wrestling after all this time, I suppose. Anyway, Bard, you returned to ICW in September. For Bard on Triller, all steel cage match show. I don't know if you've done a steel cage match before this, but it's the old school kind of steel cage as well. Yellow bars, black bars. So we've been 1999 era cage matches, kind of held kind of cage matches. Match should come back, by the way. Coming back to ICW. How was that?
I mean, mate, is anything going to beat that? Like, really? That show, even if that show wasn't in a cage, that show would have been genuinely one of the best shows I've seen in a, like, I can't say in a really long time, but like, because there was Thunderstruck and all that stuff, but you know what I'm trying to say? Like, it was so incredible. It really was. But mate, even, right, so pre-show, Daisy Jenkins, Angel Hayes, buzzing to get that one, right? Honestly, I really rate Angel Hayes. I think she's excellent. And I was dying to ref Daisy because I had a feeling it would be good, and it bloody was, you know, it was excellent. It was incredible. And that's what the pre-show is. So I'm pumped as hell now, right? I'm like, right, okay, I've got, looking at the cage, my heart was going, like I had butterflies and everything. It was excitement, all the nerves, to be honest. I was terrified of the look of it because you think you go into the cage, you don't think, right, you go into the cage, but I'm not going to get chinned. You know what I mean? Like, you don't think about that until you're in the cage and you're not chinned. And but that match, like, honestly, that was excellent. And because it was do the match and then stand and be the ref at the door, do the match, stand and be the ref at the door, do the match. It was, I got to be out the whole show, apart from the main event, right, which I'm glad I got to watch and not be part of, because I wouldn't want to take no choke slam or anything like that. But I would if ICW asked us, you know what I mean? And I would learn how to do it very well. But I really did enjoy watching the main event, like, you know, on the like the come down of that was one of the best nights of my life, right? Like, I don't know what's going to top that one. And that match, oh my God, like, Steve, like, oh, all of it was amazing, right? I'm going to, and oh, Lana winning, right? Okay, and Rampage, oh, Ashton, it was, you see what I'm trying to say?
That was Ashton's final.
Amazing.
Match,
yeah, I think, yeah. I don't know if he had one more recently, but that match, like, I didn't know that. And so being on the outside, like, at the door, like, obviously holding it there, and it was when he did the bow, I was like, what's that? Oh, and, like, you know how it all, like, clicks in your head? And I thought, that is the, you know what, that is the match that you would want to go out on. Like, what a show. But that match was wonderful. Like, even the parts where Rampage is chinning them with the gear and the gear's flying everywhere. And, you know, I really rate Arcade Violence as well. Their theme, like, even that, you know what, right? Their theme is the song of the weekend for me. Because I think we heard it twice as well. But it's just, you know, like, let's be honest, it's such a theme. But the whole show, I don't know what experience I could ever have that would feel more like the highest production value I've ever seen. The, like, the comms set even is, like, on another level. Even the way that they have everything written out and, like, you know what time to the minute everything is. And then being in and having the Roman cameras and, like, having everything there and being in the garage, mate. I was in the garage in a cage. Like, you can't make this up. You talk about bucket lists. There's to be like, you couldn't even make that up to put on your bucket list. You know what I mean? Like, oh, so good. I'll never get over the joy of what that was.
It's genuinely, like, from all the buzz coming out of that, I think that's probably one of the first shows since the return of the pandemic where people are paying attention and going, ICW's back. Like, that seemed to be the vibe coming out of it. I don't know if it was because it was the garage or just everything, just the stars aligned on that night, or because they had Ref Katie on the card. Maybe that was the real reason for all. But there was something about that show, the buzz online. I've still to watch it, which is really irritating. I've got it loaded up and ready. I just need to find hours of time to watch it. But it seems like, yeah, ICW's back, and there's a whole hell of a lot of buzz coming out of it. With that being said, they're coming back to Newcastle 3rd of November for Backcountry. Now, have you already been in the DMs? Are you already going, my services are available?
I'm actually back in, like, ICW on this Sunday. I'm back up Glasgow. Yeah, so I'm back there. This weekend is insane. It's North on Saturday, the Comic-Con for Iron Girders on Sunday daytime, and then ICW at the nighttime. So I'm just pulling a bit of a mad one, but I can do it. I'm telling you, the adrenaline gets me through. I can do this. But I haven't heard anything about Newcastle. If they want to have me, I am definitely available. I'm probably just going to like go as a fan if they don't ask, because who wants to, like, you don't want to miss the show like that. You want to go. If you're going to work it, you get to see what happens. If you're not going to work it, go as a fan and enjoy it. Because Ref Carson and Ref Thomas are just brilliant. It's no competition. It's nothing like that. It's, hey, do you need a hand for the show? I'll be there. If not, no problem. I'm still going to support because I love this product. You see where I'm coming from?
Absolutely. I'm just having a wee look. I'm just loading up in my peripheral vision here. The card for the Comic Con show for Iron Girders, who have put on some absolutely incredible shows. That they sometimes put them like streaming on Twitch, so I get to watch them from up in the I'm in the northeast of Scotland. So they've just put on incredible shows. So day two, yeah, you got Daisy and Moxie. That's going to be cracking. We've got possibly Luke Cairo, BT Gunn. The BT Gunn match that you can get in there with, and Deadpool versus Wolverine. I'm interested to see what happens. So yeah, it's absolutely, and refereeing at a Comic Con. Now, I don't want to judge you, QK, but I'm assuming you're a bit of a nerd. So refereeing at a Comic Con, that's again this bucket list, that's or the delusional bucket list. That must be like in pencil there, wasn't it?
This is the thing, right? I think I've got it. I've got a way to answer it. So I feel like everything. That's the 2-hour move, and there's nothing crazy going on. That's all right. I feel like things are coming and happening that are so perfect, you couldn't have made it up to put on a list. Do you know what I'm trying to say? Like having an all-stage show in the garage for ICW, two women's matches, Jack Jester main event, all of it. Really, like, you cannot make Rampage Brown, Ashton Smith, Arcade, like, you can't make it up to put it on a list. Do you know what I mean? It's when you know it's better than a bucket list could have been, that's when you're onto some fire there, though, isn't it? Like, but mate, I'm not going to lie, I didn't even realise that that was something that happened. So as soon as I seen it, I was like, bloody hell, like, that looks class. I wonder how the hell I would get involved with that one. And that's when BT messaged, and I was like, this is the best day ever, do you know what I mean? But honestly, I've got so much respect for BT. BT Gunn has gave us multiple opportunities now to ref the girders, and it helps so much, especially early doors where it was being around so much quality. And this is the thing, I feel like every time I go to Scotland, I'm in the ring with so much quality. I feel like I learn so much. It's so worth the, like, the train, the coach up, the drive up, anything, because you gain so much value from it. Do you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. I love being up there. Like, I'm just thinking about the last show I did with PWR, how excellent that was. But then I've got Target, which is next week as well. But again, a brilliant show. In fact, ICW, though, sorry. No, Gerda, sorry what you're saying. I'm really excited. I can't believe I'm going to be, like, walking through the pod that isn't the front door that you paid to get in. Do you know what I mean?
Just to flash the lanyard going, no. Paid talent.
You think I'll get a lanyard?
Why not? I mean, we should pay your rider.
Probably, you know, I'll hang it up. I'll put it on my fridge next to my ICW run sheet.
You have to get a rider at this point. Going, I request blue skittles and they do blue skittles. I think they're Smarties. Oh my god, I'm so old. yeah, lanyard for all my shows.
I'm just happy to be there.
You mentioned PWR. Sorry, I think you may have said it earlier on. Well, the Fife shows up in Leven.
Yes.
Oh man, those shows look incredible. Was that the most
they
recent?
Are.
Was it something of power?
They had, like, the double up.
It was the tag team one, wasn't it? The mm-hmm. tag team tournament kind of thing. No.
They had I did the show on the Saturday, and then on the Sunday they had one at a Truth venue, I believe it was called. It looked like an incredible show, like really great venue. But the one I did on the Saturday, oh, brilliant. There was two debuts. There was Kay Calloway, who is actually on Fighting Moxie on Sunday. Got the ref, wonderful, like proper strong, jack glasses. I love it.
Power Pro. There it is. I found it. Unforgiven. Kate Calloway versus Aaron Taylor. So I think it was Aaron's first actual main show match outside of galas as well. So
she looked like a badass though. She was fine. Honestly, we're talking. She, you know what? Right, again, like for her debut match, for how much she spoke back to it, I cannot tell you how much I appreciate that. Because I'd noticed she had quite a bit of blood in her mouth. It was fine. It was just a front bump. You know, when you're just a little, like, what do they call it? What would you call it? I can't remember what they call it, but she was totally fine. But with it being her debut, and I knew she'd be so full of adrenaline, I really did just want to check she was okay. So, like, and Kate as well. I'm telling you, Kate responded to everything brilliantly. It was fine. But because she spoke back to us, you know, the way that, like, under the breath, no one heard. I knew she was fine because she was talking real sentences. So it's like, right, okay, no problem. And then afterwards, get the medic just to check on her. But it's the fact that it was a debut. She nailed it. She was still switched on enough to talk back and not forget the match. And, like, credit to Kate as well, you know what I mean? It was really good, mate. Like, honestly, it really was. I really can't wait to wrestle again. I would love to go back to PWR because that was an experience. And they gave us my Rampage match that I wanted for so long.
I'm hearing the truth shows are just, yeah, are absolutely wild, like, wild for a crowd reaction to those. It's one of those things, because, I mean, you can't yourself for things like buses, trains, and all that kind of stuff.
I do it.
Jesus, it's not a cheap task, is it? Just to go and go and see some wrestling. It's mad. And I've got a 2-year-old, and that's just an expense in itself. So I've got so many emotions.
Like, it's not very often I make a chunk of however much it costs to get somewhere. But really, I don't care. I do this because I love it. Like, you know, the way that people would spend 20 quid at the golf on the weekend. I don't know. Like, and I don't drink as well. So I'm thinking about, like, my drinking money is going towards traveling around.
I know. I think my thoughts are once he's a little bit older, I'm just going to just write the list of companies I want to get to. I'll take him with me and we'll just cross it off as we go. Because I've got girders being one of them, Power Pro being another, and I've taken off ICW a long time ago, but to see what they're new, need to see again. I recently ticked off Discovery, which is one that took me 10 years to do, so hopefully it's gonna take me a little less time to get Power Pro. Right, I'm gonna get into some questions because we've got quite a few, and we've got Ian Skinner, basically Iron Skinner there because we're speaking about iron girders, he'll love that. Ian Skinner asks, ask her about her cool nickname.
Iceblade. Right. He's crap. I love Ian. Right, so basically in a nutshell, I needed a new last name, a couple of reasons. The first one was work, we're giving us hell for it, but work is, you know, right? Honestly, like, it's with them. But to be fair, you know, probably just for myself, it's probably not you have my real name everywhere. But again, I didn't think it would spiral like this, did I? So we're here, so I had to think about some changes. It's Katie Walker now. But I was like, I was really thinking about it all and everything. And there's Ian pops up. He's like, we need something. Like, stands out there. He's like, I've got it. Iceblade. And so if you look at my Twitter bio now, it actually, on the X bio, sorry, it actually has a little ice blade there. That's what that is. So forever there will be the Ian Skinner shout out because it honestly makes me laugh. You know, on Dodgeball, where they're like, Laser, Blazer, Michelle. Yeah. I feel like every time I hear ice blade, it fits into that.
You could have given me a million guesses on the name that you would have come up with. Ice blade would have been nowhere near it.
I don't know. He's so funny though, but you know, cool guy, lots of friends.
Here's me thinking, do I change the graphic now that we use for the thumbnail, just put Iceblade? for one joke about an hour into the podcast, will people get it? Will people be there? So
Bischoff or Iceblade, it's up to you.
I like that it's Walker though, after you tell us about the Walker Dome and it being a special venue for you, so that's a nice little like nod to your youth and growing up and everything thrown in Walker. So we've got Matt from the Mat, which is a fantastic username.
Isn't it though? Matt's great.
He's asked, if Katie could ref one match from the past, what would it be? So I'll let you choose whether it's a match you didn't do or one you want to go back to. Just, yeah, interpret it as you wish.
I've got two that came to mind straight away, and I won't hop on about them because I know what I'm like. The first one was Shinsuke Nakamura's debut on with Sami Zayn on NXT, because watching it, I got goosebumps from the electricity in the room that I felt through the ship, like through the screen. I would have loved it being there for that. Third time seeing him doing that entrance, like the way that that match is honestly one of my like genuine favorite matches of all time. But it's the vibe of the room. I feel like because it was in NXT, small, you know where I'm coming from. I just really would have liked that one. And another one, another NXT one actually. For the story, people don't give this match enough credit, right? Number one, Asuka is genuinely favorite. Female referee wrestler of all time. Like right now, I've got an Asuka mask on the Halloween tree. But it was Asuka versus Emma in London with Dana Brooke. Now, hear me out. It's an obscure one, right? But there was ref distraction. There was storytelling. There was like the despair for Asuka. Like, how can't this badass, like, bitch, put this woman out? And it was all of it, the way that it worked. I know that it sounds obscure, but I would have loved to have read Asuka versus Emma, NXT in London. But yeah, I think it's, again, my favourite time of any wrestling is Black and Gold NXT. And then how much I was just consumed with how much I loved NXT. Like, I didn't care about anything else. It was every week, just given that it's the best thing I've ever seen. Ooh. But I was at this one, right, as well. Oh, my God. It was TakeOver, Philly, Aleister Black, Adam Cole, Extreme Rules, where they turned the chairs in, inverted the night before the Philly Rumble, which, brilliant again, right? So the night before the Philly Rumble, when they turned the chairs inverted and Aleister Black had got Cole on the chairs like that, and when Aleister went through the tables off the ropes, it was those three. They are the first three that come to mind. Ooh, one more, and then I'll honestly shut up, right? It was WCPW, Newcastle University, Will Ospreay, B Priestley, Ricochet, Tessa Blanchard, while they were on the figure, I would, mate, come on, give me that match in Newcastle. Where were we getting that Newcastle? But to be fair, you know, Kurt Angle and Wallace, Matt, and Bret Hart, who I bumped into on the street in New York once, but that's a story for a different day as well. Right, I'm done, though. There you go, Matt. Loads of love, mate.
Well, the first thing I've got from that is, you have a Halloween tree.
I do.
I think if my wife could get away with it, we would also have a Halloween tree. But
get one.
No, I have to take the thing down from the loft. I'm only doing it when it's Christmas. I'm not doing it Halloween as well.
I'm just gonna keep mine up.
But is it like a neutral color where it can be?
No, black and orange.
All right, okay. So it's definitely a Halloween tree. It's not like you can throw some tinsel on it and go Halloween tree, and then take it off and go Christmas tree.
No, pumpkins all over it and that as well. And an Asuka mask.
How long has it been up?
Longer than I'd care to be.
I felt that pause. I felt you just going,
yeah.
I'm not admitting this.
Just a while.
Last year. It's fine. So one question that Ian also asks is, would you rather have unlimited bacon but no more games, or games, unlimited games but no games?
Unlimited games, no bacon.
Nice and easy there.
Yeah, I don't really like bacon. It's actually shockingly simple. Right.
Shocking, right. Well, end the interview there. But no, you're the first person that's just got straight answered it, I think, in a long time. A lot of people just take that question and go, I think my brain broke. So that's nice. That's
no,
there you
go.
Easy question to answer. Right, let's see what else I've got here on the old question front. Sean Moran, who I forgot earlier.
Oh, hi, Sean.
He has asked two questions. One I'm going to use as kind of like the nice little wrap-up question. But the first one is, favourite matches or shows you've done so far?
Every single ICW one I've ever done, let's be honest. With Bard being right up there, as well as Grado's return. The Thunderstruck. But hear me out, right, about Thunderstruck. Even if it wasn't in the venue, even if that match wasn't, you know, in front of everyone or anything like that, it was an incredible match. It was a fatal four-way. Natalie Sykes, Eve Bateman, Ali Catch, and Debbie Keitel in it for the best, slugging it out for like 15 minutes. It was an excellent match. But, you know, you've got to remember that you'll finish that match and it's like, that was the best thing I've ever done. And then you walk around there and it's like, oh, there's Elias. Oh, Joe Hendry. Oh, there you go. Do you know what? It's just like, the list is like never ended. Oh, there's the UFO, you know, like all these people that you think are like just genuinely incredible. And then right. So I think my personal favorite BWR, I don't, it's not the last one, it was the one beforehand, but the last one was setting up my stomach good, you know, mate. But there was the one before that. It was Scotty Roque and Will Cruz, main event. It was just refs taken out everywhere. I took a bump off the belt and then got thrown into the ring post. Adam Devlin comes back. Huge, mate. Honestly, just everyone ripping everyone apart. Like, good guy, bad guy. You know how it goes. It was chaos. But, you know, where it's like, I genuinely could not wait to go to the next BWR to find out what happens. Do you know what I mean? Like, that's how good it was. Where else have I been? Let's have a think, mate. I'm a blank. I'm genuinely a blank. I'm gonna, you know what, right? I've actually been so incredibly lucky that I've done a cutty amount already that I'm kind of forgetting. When you do everything so, like, what's the word I'm looking for?
Like, condensed and...
Yeah, it meshes into one a little bit.
So you're probably thinking more as I ask a couple more questions then. So you mentioned there taking a bump and all that kind of stuff, like getting thrown around and ring posts and what have you. Like, is how do you mentally prepare for that sort of thing? Or I mean, how do you physically prepare as well? But how do you like mentally prepare to know that you're going to you're going to have a bit more than counting to do that night?
Focus, mate. I've got ADHD and it's hard, I'm not gonna lie. Like, I'm one of those lucky people though who got diagnosed, like, you know, in the early 20s, 31 now, so I've had a long time to, like, you know what's going on and everything. And I think that being quite honest about it, having that long to know what's going on in my brain is enough to be able to figure out how to make it work. So, for example, let's say I need to remember three things in a match, a distraction, a bump, and the finish. Let's say it's those three things. That's all I need. Like, that's all I can think about. And I like to ask, and this is a really good tip that, to be totally honest, I can't remember who told us. I've been doing it for a while, because when they told, it was Scott or Rich. I find out what happens just before each of those things as well. Then I get ready. And then when I see that, it's like, right, okay, man, you got it. You know what I'm... Does that make any sense? Being very tongue-tied with my words, because I'm thinking about about a thousand thoughts at once, and I've still got the Arcade Violence theme song running in the background of my head too. But it's a lot of just trying so hard to focus. Like, when I get out there, I can't look at the crowd. As far as I'm concerned, they're not there. They are, but, like, obviously I love all of the noise and everything, but I can't look at them or it throws us out of the zone. And somebody said to watch it do it once, which I don't know if that's a good thing or not. But they basically watched it, like, come out. And it was at North, because Tom Campbell does this following contest is scheduled for Katie Paul, and the crowd goes, Katie Paul, and they do it for John Paul, Rich Paul, Ross Paul. But that like, it braces every time. Like, it's so good. I'm not going to lie. Like, you know what I mean? Like, one of those kinds of moments. And the watches after that, it's as if I basically just, like, take a deep breath and I'm like, and then it's like mildly pissed off eyes. Do you know what I mean? I think that helps, being like, right, okay, fun's over, focus. Do you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, I was thinking, I don't know if ADHD would help. I mean, because you'd be able to try and you got your eyes on everything kind of thing. But I suppose, and like you're saying, good, it actually stops you focusing. You need to actually focus on a couple things at the same time. So it's referee, and every time I get a referee on here, I realize even more that it is way more difficult than anyone ever
gives it credit for.
Because I've seen some bad refs, and I've seen some great refs. I've seen some great refs because I haven't seen the ref. That's how I know I've seen a great ref. I don't know they're there, but I've seen some bad refs, and I definitely know they're there. And I'm like, I can't stop it. Kind of thing. Kind of
that's
like,
awesome. Invisible.
What
I've been told.
I mean, my biggest pet peeve watching referees. It's not even a thing a referee does. It's the crowd fast counting.
It's so hard, man.
And if someone with ADHD like yourself, that must be
it's a struggle.
Yeah, so, horrible thing.
I have to do this. You know what? Right, I'm not even ashamed to bury myself, right? Because on Saturday, just gone, I was like, hey. Like, really had to genuinely check this finger. I couldn't figure out, like, eight just kept back in, right? But I think I'm not gonna lie, right? With the adrenaline, it is quite easy as soon as you step through the curtain when the adrenaline's really like it's like electricity, like it's been plugged in, it is really easy to be on the side of ADHD that is your friend where you can genuinely hear everything in the ear. That's fine. You don't take your eyes off what's going on. If I zone away, that's it. But to be fair, if I zone away, which really doesn't happen that much because I'm so hell-bent on not messing up, that it's watch every move. And I think that's where, you know, that face where it's like the furrowed brow one that my pal told us about, right? I think that's where that comes from because I'm genuinely focusing my eyes on every single thing. But as well, mate, you know, you've got to remember, like, I really want to help keep people safe. Mm-hmm. So that's another reason of the adrenaline running through and, like, you're watching every single thing that's happening because you want to keep them safe. Like, if you miss a time, like, I'm at that beautiful luxury now where I'm a little bit comfortable, you know, and I'm in me rookie year, you know what I mean? I'm not saying I'm one of the better ones at all. What I'm saying is I'm feeling a bit more comfortable to be able to say, I'll ignore that time cue to check on them. Like, you know what I mean? I'll ignore that time cue to just, like, double check because I can just double tap and someone will tell us what it is again. Like, it's that kind of thing. Just having a bit more confidence with what's going on to focus more on the safety. Like, I don't know if that's just me being a bit over the top with it, but, like, my main bit is the safety of it all because even if I look shit, which I hope I don't, I go to bed that night and I know I really did try and keep doing my bit to keep them safe. Mm-hmm. Even if I do, but I really hope I don't look crap.
And with that confidence as well, it saves, like, next time a company goes, anyone in the Northeast need a referee, like, you probably will still get it sent by a million people, but gaining that confidence means that you're going to see it and you're just going to do it. You're just going to go, yeah, I've got this body of work. Nobody's been hurt on my watch.
It's so, I'm just so grateful that I can say that I've genuinely done these things. It's not just bollocks that I'm spouting. I forgot this for the interview and I started swearing. I'm sorry. I'm so sorry. I've really got this aside.
It's in Scotland. I think bollocks is quite the low end of the scale.
That is very fair. But to nutshell from me, I cannot get enough of Scottish wrestling. Like, I'm so lucky to have everything we've got going on in England. I mean, like, such a small part of, like, such a huge machine of what's going on. But I love refereeing in Scotland. It's something about the crowd. I don't know what it is. If it's the crowd, if it's the quality. And I'm not saying that that England's not quality at all. That is absolutely not what I'm saying. It's just it's different. And I don't know how. I can't put my hands on it. I like it.
I think for England, it seems the shows are huge, as in, like, the scale's grander. Whereas Scotland, the shows are a bit more compact when it comes to crowds, and they're a bit more rowdier and louder because of that.
Yeah.
It's literally, and I've just thought of this, popped in my head, I think England's kind of like your WWE, where the production's a bit more grander, it's a bit bigger, it's a bit more flashier, and then maybe Scotland's a bit more AEW, where it's a bit more gritty, and a bit...
Nah, ECW.
We'll go ECW then, yeah. Underground feel to it, regardless if it's a church or it's a hotel lobby venue kind of thing. It's there's just an underground grittiness to Scottish wrestling that seems to just carry through wherever you go.
And one more thing, I'm really sorry you didn't even cut it out, but I just want to say how nice and how well everyone treats us when I go there. Like, I cannot tell you how nice everybody is, how welcoming everybody is, and that's across the board. That's from PWR, that's from Target, that's from Gerda's, that's from ICW. Like, Pat Wolf, for example, one of the most beautiful people on the planet, has no reason to be as nice to us as what she actually is. What a girl's girl. Like, all of them who are there, everybody, even Jack Jesser is one of the nicest guys, like, to be around. He's so happy as well. Like, people might laugh and be like, oh, but he's grumpy or whatever. No. And I'm not saying he's grumpy. It's just like, you know how it's like, oh, whatever, you always say that about the best. But no, he's so much fun to be around. Like, and I cannot thank Thomas Cairns enough for, in my opinion, changing my, like, my look in refereeing, if you know what I mean. And I've actually went to him to have, he's reviewed one of my matches before. Couldn't recommend that enough for a referee. If you want to get a real deep dive into one of your matches, go Tom, so good. It's just everyone seems so nice to us. It's I think as well, I love going to Scotland because I know it's going to be a good time for everything, for the matches, for the crowd, for the experience, for the even the view on the travel up, for the people. They are so nice to me. So nice to me.
I think it's because in the time we've spoken, you seem like a genuine person who enjoys what they do. I don't think there's any facade to Iceblade over here. But no, you seem like a genuine. I've had Cat Wolf on this podcast as well, and genuinely, I think we spent about 15 minutes of that podcast talking about her being a mermaid. So that was. That was a fascinating experience. I not enough kind words about Cat Wolf. She just seems the nicest person.
All the girls at ICW, all the girls all over Scotland, really. All the guys all over, everyone else. It's just brilliant.
So we've dragged the term bucket list to the depths of being said so many times. But is there any companies in Scotland specifically that you're like, yeah, we'll try and get to that. Actually, no, before you answer that question, because I want to finish off the actual stuff about North, being in the venue for Joe Hendry's song for Elijah, how was that?
Oh, mate, I mocked out me, you know, I've got no shame. It was such a laugh. I think that's what it is, right? Because everybody was up for it. Do you know what I mean? The crowd was up for it. Everybody was up for it. And, mate, that's fun, that, you know, that was a good time. Let's be honest, you knew what you were going to get, and it just went over it. Do you know what I mean? So good.
Absolutely. And that was kind of him just hot off his first appearance, couple of years as an NXT, so just incredible. Anyway, yes, so back to the old ad nauseum bucket list phrase, which is probably a phrase lost all meaning in the chat. But yeah, is there any companies, I'm assuming, like, how we're chatting, that Discovery is probably thrown in there, because Sandy's done a couple of shows there, they seemed to, well, it took me 10 years to go to one, but they're absolute riot of shows to go to, so assuming that's on there, is there any other particular companies that have caught your eye that you'd like to get to?
There's loads that I see pop up, so to be honest, sorry, I do this every time. I'd love to work Discovery. I'd love to do like more of what I'm doing as well. I'd love to do more with ICW. I'd love to do more with Gerda's. I'd love to be back to PWR. But I'd quite like to go to the community. That looks really fun as well. So community, Discovery, Valor looks like a big good time as well, where we know Ref Sean is. That looks like a really fun time. In the Grand Ole Opry, isn't it? It looks like a really good venue. Mm-hmm. The venue that I like the look of. Apologies if I'm missing a big one or an obvious one, but apart from that, with Scotland, that's definitely what it is. And with England, the one I would love to be able to be part of is Eve, you know, the old women's show around London. Yeah. I would love to be part of that. Like, I'm not going to lie, but I am really happy with everything that is going on, that even if I never left again, I would be like, damn, that was fun. You know what I mean? And, like, probably the best year of my life. because it's stuff that, like we've said before, to kick the bucket list away, it's stuff that was delusional. It wasn't even on the bucket list. It was delusional that it happened, and it's like, whoa.
And you've seen where it can go. I mean, Sandy doing WOS, you've seen likes of like
so
Jess
well
Carter, TNA referees as well. So there's no, there's literally like maybe 5-10 years ago there would be you wouldn't have got that far because you're a woman. But nowadays there's literally nothing that'll stop you from possibly being in a WWE ring, being in an AEW ring, being in a TNA ring, that can stop you, which must be thrilling, especially as someone who would have came up watching wrestling when it was possibly not women friendly, really, when it came to career paths and all that kind of thing. So the fact that the bucket list, yeah, like I say, it's non-existent because everything's incredible that you can do. Must be just amazing being you. That's kind of where I'm rounding off that there.
I'm not gonna lie, mate, it's been a really good year. But like you've said, you've got people like Ref Sandy who they deserve what they are doing. Like everything Sandy would get, she's worked so hard for it. She hasn't got anything handed to her. She's worked for it, and she's unbelievably talented. Like her being on World of Sport with James Greenwood is incredible. She shouldn't just be given one bunch of flowers. She should have like an absolute like ton of flowers thrown at her. Throw all the roses at Sandy and the lilies and the orchids because they are expensive, so I'm told. But and LK is incredible. She's having a baby at the minute, but as soon as she comes back, we'll all know about it. She'll be steaming through, you know. And it's cool, mate. It really is, because when we were growing up, there was no lady ref. And now there's lady ref Jess who owns it, and I love it. And I'm not going to lie, it's kind of cool because already in a few places, I don't get called like the female ref. I get called ref. And that's the goal. In reality, for a lot of female refs you'll speak to, to just be called ref. But I also have a lot of pride in being a female ref. So I'm not like, what's the word? I'm not like mad at anyone saying it. I'm not bothered. It's just, that's the, you know, you'll hear that with a lot across loads of sports, I'd imagine, where it's like not female footballer, it's just footballer. But I have a lot of pride about being a female ref in this world. And it's been magic so far. Like, so let's see what happens.
And the fact that you can be doing a show and there'll be a little girl in the crowd that'll look at you and go,
you'll get it.
I could do that. I could be part of the show as well.
I've never thought of that. Don't. That's like, oh wow.
So that's your pressure put on for the weekend then. That it could be.
Man, it's a mental weekend and all what you're doing though, isn't it?
It's fine. There'll be no little girls at ICW. That's all right. It's an 18 show.
It's the Comic Con. Moxie Daisy's so good.
I'm going to see Moxie wrestle on Saturday. Actually, she's in Dundee for Fair City, and I'm absolutely buzzing because I've seen her wrestle on YouTube and that, but I've never seen Moxie wrestle live.
You never seen Moxie? Oh, she's a badass, you know.
And I'm on comms. It's the first ever commentary that I'm doing. One of the matches. It's Moxie Malone versus Brody Adler. So I'm just like, oh, Casino Brutale's on that show. No, I've talked about that.
Brutale, right. Brutale. Watch their entrance. What an entrance they have. Oh, the you know what, right? They are two of the loveliest lads I've met in wrestling as well. Met them going up girders. They've always been so nice to us, so supportive. But they're bloody good in the ring, you know, mate.
Absolutely. Yeah, again, another one that I've just admired from afar, and then I'm gonna be calling one of their matches, and I'm like, oh, this tables match, and God, all my dreams are coming true.
Oh, you are going to have a blast. Like, let's know how that goes.
I can't wait. I'm just, as long as I don't shit the bed, literally, like, as long as I don't, like, absolutely screw it up, I'm just like, I'm there to enjoy myself.
You'll be
anyway,
fine.
I'll be all right. I mean, we've proven that I can speak absolute nonsense for an extended period of time. And
you kept my attention.
We're still going. The last question I've got through is from Sean Moran again, and you kind of covered it earlier, so I want to kind of leave it a little bit further in so you can just talk at length about it. He's asked, how great is the ref community in wrestling?
Oh, mate, 10 out of 10. You hear a lot of the time, like, you know, like, oh, what's the phrase? And I'm looking for, I've got it. like, oh, you know, like the boys, or like, you know, how it's all like everyone's tied together. And I guess the rapper community to me is like the boys, where like these people are so solid. Like, I cannot tell you how much I trust them, how much like I just appreciate them. I love being around the refs. The refs help us so much. They've helped us so much from day one. They'll help us so much until I give up the stripes, which won't be anytime soon by my choice, because this is the best year ever. I just love them, mate. I love all refs. If you're a ref, come and see us. I love you.
Well, that seems like a nice way to end our chat. I think we could probably end up speaking about everything and anything for the next wee while, but
I know. Sorry, mate. I'll try and keep it together.
I honestly don't. I love guests that can just talk and have stories, because like it makes my life easy, because I don't have to go. Right, I need to find a question to try and get this moving along. So you've been an absolutely fabulous guest. Where can people find out more about Ref Katie Walker, Iceblade? Where can people find out more about you?
Where I went to school?
So, social media, I'm guessing.
Oh.
What's your address?
Oh my god. Sorry. On Instagram, RefKatie123, and on X, I don't actually know. I think it's RefKatie.
I would have literally told you, but for some reason my Chrome decided to go.
Oh, sorry. No, I've absolutely threw myself. I think
you think we've got gone through this far, and I've just suddenly like turned a corner and went, I want to know where you live.
No, I thought you meant just more like generalized facts, like what's Katie's favorite drink?
What's your Wikipedia? It's Katie Crosby _123.
That's
the one. I think that sums up the general vibe my podcast brings. It's just a little bit of chaos at the end there. But no, this has been an absolutely fantastic chat. Thank you very much for taking the time to speak to me. And here's to another year.
Thank you very much, mate. Thank you for having us on, and have a lovely day.